Hi guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and I'm here today at the Rock Island Auction House taking a look at, well, one of the anti-tank rifles that they're going to be selling in their upcoming May of 2017 premier auction. This is a Swedish M42. I'm going to mess this up, but it's going to be something like Pansarvärnsgevär. It's an anti-tank rifle. And it's a really interesting hybrid style of system. So it is a solid 20mm projectile, and quite the potent one too. That is 108 gram projectile traveling at 950 meters per second. For us Americans, that's like a 1650 grain bullet going at 3150 feet per second. So that's heavy and fast, and it's a tungsten cord armor piercing bullet. But it's a recoilless rifle, in name, if not strictly speaking in practice. What we're looking at here is the first development, or one of the very early developments, getting away from the idea of just a standard anti-tank rifle. Now, this began in World War I, when the Germans needed something to counter the emerging British tank threat, and they basically scaled up the Mauser bolt-action rifle to 13mm, big armor-piercing projectile going nice and fast, and that worked pretty well on British tanks in World War I. Then, during the interwar period, pretty much all the major military powers in the world would work on developing that sort of thing. So the British had the Boys anti-tank rifle in 55 caliber. The Germans and the Poles both developed 8mm, but very high velocity anti-tank rifles. The Finns had the 20mm Lotti. The Swiss developed the 20mm Solothurn S-1000s. Everyone was building bigger and bigger anti-tank rifles. And these were all on the same principle as a rifle, a locked breech, and powder explodes and all of the force pushes the bullet down the barrel into the tank. The problem was, by the time World War II really got going, these were kind of reaching the point of diminishing returns. Tank armor was getting heavier, and it was getting past the point where you could actually have a reasonably portable rifle that could actually penetrate the armor. So some of the better ones were these 20mm Swiss and Finnish guns, but you're looking at like a 120-pound gun at that point, and that starts to really push the limits of portability. And at that point, you're like, you know, maybe we should just step it up a little bit to like a 37 or a 50mm gun and make it an artillery piece, because we're losing the portability of a rifle already anyway. Well, what would eventually develop were shaped charge projectiles, where instead of depending on a hardened armor-piercing bullet core to just power through the armor based on its velocity, instead you'd get an explosive charge that was shaped in such a way that it would create a very thin stream of molten metal that could cut through armor using thermal properties instead of just velocity. And this is a hybrid between those two. So the thing is, with a shaped charge, you've got a relatively large diameter projectile, and you can't just fire that through a rifle. This is one of the early recoilless guns, which is the technology that was developed to allow shaped charge projectiles to be used effectively. Now, one way to do that is a rocket, which is, say, what the US did with the bazooka. The other way is a recoilless rifle. Now, the idea behind, first of all, recoilless doesn't actually mean there's no recoil. It just means there's substantially less. And the reason for that is it's firing both directions at the same time. This concept goes, frankly, back to the US Civil War, where there was a development of a gun that fired a charge of shot, charge in both directions simultaneously. And the idea was this would count, the recoil of the one going backward counteracted the recoil of the one going forward. So yes, you're losing half of the energy of the cartridge, but if you make that, you can make that cartridge very large and still be man portable because you're not trying to contain it all. And so it's worthwhile. That's what this did. So we'll take a look at this up close in a minute, but the base of this cartridge, instead of being totally sealed, actually has like a little fiberboard pad that is deliberately intended to blow out when you fire. And the propellant gases go shooting out the back of the gun. You don't try to contain them like in a locked breech rifle. So you're wasting a lot of the energy, but you're able to get what is effectively a more powerful round than something like the Lotti or the Solothurn in an 11 kilo or just under 25 pound single man portable weapon. And that was a really interesting concept. Now, this was developed by the Carl Gustav company from basically between 1940 and 1942. It was adopted into Swedish military service in 42. It's interesting, the Swedes had a lot of kind of stuff a little bit ahead of the game in World War II, despite being not a substantially combatant nation. They had a 1942 pattern semi-automatic rifle as well, which was actually a really good rifle, the Jungmann. Anyway, they would order like 3,200 of these, although only about 1,000 of them had been actually delivered by the time the war ended. And they, of course, never really saw combat. What these really did was help lead to the development of the 1946 to 48 development of the 84 millimeter Carl Gustav recoilless rifle, which is a fantastically long-serving weapon. Versions of that weapon are still in military service today. And this is really what sparked the development of that rifle. We'll start with the ammo, and this should give you a decent size comparison. There's a nice full clip of 30-06 for an M1 compared to a single cartridge for the M42 anti-tank rifle. Now, this is a 180 millimeter long cartridge, which is just ludicrously huge. But remember that this is not a locked breech. So a lot of this powder is being vented out, well, all the powder is being vented out the back of the gun, which means you're losing a lot of the potential thrust to the bullet. So the amount of powder is oversized to compensate for that in the first place. Looking at the back of the case, you can see a standard primer right there, but then we have this brown area in the middle. Now, when we look at a fired case, you'll see that primer is dimpled and this is blown out in these two areas. And again, that's deliberate. That's what makes this recoilless, is the energy. While there's a solid bullet going forward, there is a lot of powder and debris going backwards. And that's what balances the recoil and makes this a practical gun to actually fire from the shoulder. It is loaded from the back, and this would be operated by a team, of course. So you'd have a gunner and a loader. What the loader is going to do is push this lever forward, which is going to unlock the breech, and then allow it to pivot open, actually on this side. Push that forward, and then it pivots open like this. Got a little bit of extra kick at the end, which operates the extractor. All right, and then we have the chamber. Our extractor is right here. It's spring-loaded, so you have to push it in order to close the breech. And then when you open, if the spring pressure itself isn't enough to push the case out, you can kick it open a bit like that to push the case. This is our Venturi nozzle. So powder blast is going to come out of there. You do not want to stand behind this thing. We have a trigger up here at the front with a safety switch, so it's currently on fire. When I pull the trigger, it's a really simple mechanism. There's just a long transfer bar that goes all the way down this tube until it reaches the back right here. When I pull the trigger, it's just going to push that bar back. And that bar connects to this right there, which trips a striker and releases the firing pin. So this is our actual breech block. It has the same pattern of openings right there that you see very obviously burned into the empty fired cartridge case, right there. Now this plate does very quickly erode, as you might expect. It's getting a lot of very high pressure gas on it when you fire. Apparently this plate lasts about 20 rounds of armor piercing ammunition or about 40 rounds of practice or high explosive. Unlike a lot of anti-tank rifles, this thing was actually made with or shipped with or equipped with both solid armor piercing and high explosive projectiles. And the high explosive, because it wasn't velocity dependent, was a little bit lower pressure and thus less damaging to the gun to fire. There's a carry handle right here, pretty much at the balance point of the gun, just for general transit. But then when you're actually firing, this is your shoulder rest. You have a nice padded cheek rest here. And then the front end contains your firing grip, firing mechanism, and sights. There are two different types of sights on here. We have a set of folding iron sights. These are calibrated to 300 meters. Just a little front post like that. And then we also have an optical sight. Interestingly, this is a Miopta, made in Czechoslovakia, and it is basically a ZF4 optic, which is pretty cool. In fact, it is a ZF4. It is detachable, like so. This also comes out, it's a little bit loose at the moment, but you could take the optical sight mount off if you didn't want to use it. And if you did, this is your scope unit. Right there, Miopta. And then it's a 4-power scope, 4.5-degree field of view, and a serial number. And then it is on this externally adjusted mount. So there are the standard ZF4 elevation and windage adjustments, which you would use for zeroing. But then once it's on, once the scope's zeroed, your range adjustments are all done using this dial, which moves the mount, pivots it quite a lot. Because the trajectory of that 20mm is going to be substantially different than, say, an 8mm rifle bullet that this scope was originally designed around. There's also a windage adjustment here that's going to slide the scope in its mount. And the BDC is calibrated out to 1,000 meters. Now, the reticle on this is pretty much a standard ZF4 with a German post, but it does also have a couple of additional stadia lines, kind of box-shaped stadia lines in there, which I believe are for tracking a moving target. So this does balance pretty well. They've got the grip and the shoulder rest at the proper point. And yeah, it weighs about 25 pounds. It does have recoil, but not like a rifle or an anti-tank cannon kind of recoil. Armor penetration on this was better than most of the equivalent caliber guns. This could go through about 40 millimeters of tank armor, flat on, you know, 90 degrees at 100 meters distance. So that's really above most of the comparable guns. That's more than a Lotte or a Solothurn could do. And doing that in a light and portable package like this is really a neat trick. Now, even this thing's capabilities by the end of World War II, or by the middle of World War II, were not really sufficient. And that's why what this really led to was development of the 84mm recoilless Carl Gustav. So to open this thing, this would normally be done with a two-man crew, but pull the lever, rotate it open. This last little bit of spring tension pushes on the extractor, pops the empty cartridge out, put a new one in, and a push on the extractor there to release the bolt or the breech block. Pop it down, lock it in place, and you're ready to fire. You would not want to stand where the camera is now because this jets out a whole lot of flaming debris. So there are a couple of pieces of footage out there that you can find on YouTube of people actually shooting these. In fact, I don't know for sure, but I suspect at least one of those may be this exact same gun. And it's pretty cool. You can see, first off, there's a tremendous amount of backblast that you do not want to stand behind. And you can see that there is, in fact, recoil. These make a huge amount of noise and a large concussion, and they absolutely do recoil, but nowhere near the amount of recoil you would have from one of these actually firing from a locked, sealed breech. So, if you would be interested in owning this one, it comes with all the stuff up here, plus some other things. There's a carry case, sling, transit bags, all sorts of extra goodies. And you can take a look at pictures of all of those on Rock Island's website. You'll find a link to the catalog page for this piece in the description text below. And you can place a bid right there online if you're interested. This is an NFA transferable destructive device, so it does have to go through an NFA transfer. But fully transferable. So anyone who can pass the background check can own this and have a lot of fun with it. Thanks for watching.